I first got involved serving at PCC after Growth Track. In the past, there's been scenarios where, you know, I've been a member of a church and I've attended churches, but I haven't really taken ownership of my faith by, you know, actually taking that next step to be able to serve and give back to that faith community that I'm in. We had been attending the church for, I guess it was probably right about 6 months or so, maybe a year. Previously, we had been moving around a lot over the last couple years, so we hadn't really had an opportunity to put down roots. But here, you know, we kind of know we're going to be here for a little while. And Growth Track here at PCC is the way that you see where you fit into that. And here at PCC, they make it so easy to get involved and to, you know, serve.
I'm an elementary teacher. I actually teach third grade. And when we did Growth Track assessment, it reassured that I was meant to be teaching. I thought that it would just be little kids and kids ministry, and that's where I started off. I helped with them, and then Hunter wanted to try out students. And so Hunter went one night, and I just went to watch and to see what all really happened, because we hadn't been in that part of the church yet to see what happened. And the coordinator, students coordinator, just kind of threw me in a group with middle school, and I was able to connect with them, and it was great, and we had good conversations and good answers. And ever since then, I've come back, enjoyed it, and looked forward to being with those middle school kids and seeing what they have to say and what's going on in their lives and bonding.
When I see a need, I've always been that type of person. I'm very, you know, task-oriented, but I've found a way to use that as a gift to be able to, you know, serve and love people. That's always been a big thing for me that I've struggled with, is I'm not necessarily a people person, but I found some ways where I can use, you know, some aspects of my personality to be able to love people, which isn't traditionally something that I've been very good at, and I just relish those opportunities.
Coming from Mississippi, which was where I'm originally from, when we first moved here, I didn't have anybody. We had his family, but I really didn't know them quite yet. So I was looking for that place where I fit in, that purpose of where I needed to be and who I needed around me to help me grow in my faith. And I found that at PCC.
It's really helped me to see how important that this community is to me, and then how important it is to others as well. It's just a great opportunity and a great privilege to get to be a part of. And I can see all the ways that it's helping me to become a better person each and every day. I want myself to be more in the image of Christ, and every opportunity that I take to spend time around the folks here at PCC, I can just really, really feel that starting to become a bigger part of my personality and who I am.
So. Being able to connect with the students and the kids, I'm learning things spiritually that I haven't learned yet, because they're teaching me, and not only am I teaching them, it's vice versa, and we're making that bond with each other, and Christ is in the middle with us, so we're all learning together, and it's a really good feeling to know that I'm back serving.
Seeing the growth in those young kids is incredibly rewarding. So it makes a huge difference, I feel like.
I'm Hunter Hatcher.
I'm Samantha Hatcher.
We're living the dream.
Samantha and Hunter are discovering together that they can make a difference as a part of the dream team here at PCC. It's an important part of your spiritual journey, too, to be able to pair your unique makeup, your divinely assembled combination of giftedness and passion and abilities and personality and experiences, used together synergistically with others here at our church to really impact people's lives. You know, there was something subtle in their story. It's easy to miss. They didn't begin with a bullseye understanding of exactly what they were supposed to do. It took them a while and some experimentation to figure it out. And that's not just true for them. It's true for most of us. We journey towards our purpose, don't we? We experiment our way through experiences that sometimes confirm, yes, this is it, or might confirm the opposite, this is not it. And that's why they don't let me serve in kidmen around here. My idea of being with kids is, I have this philosophy, it's all about fun and pain. Fun and pain. How are those related, you might ask? Well, I think one should lead to the other. We should play hard until somebody gets hurt, and then we ought to begin with the end in mind. I mean, really, we tell our kids not to throw things at each other, but isn't that the essence of playing catch? And we want them to do that, so we ought to just begin with the end in mind. And we tell kids not to run in the house, but they don't they need to be equipped to sprint through the hallway in case there's a fire? So in fact, running around the house is preparation that just might save their lives. And we tell kids not to jump on the bed or jump on the couch, but then when they go to school, they go to PE, and then they're going to go outside and jump on hard surfaces and bare ground. Wouldn't it be better to teach them how to jump on something soft before they get there? So when I'm with kids, the reason they don't let me be around kids all the time is because when I'm with kids, I think we should just run around and yell and have all kinds of fun until, as I like to say, the playing ain't over till somebody's bleeding. And that's why they don't let me serve in Kidmen. And if you're taking notes today, I don't really know what to tell you. The truth is that not everything is a fit for everyone, but everyone has a thing that's the perfect fit for them. Not everything is a fit for everyone, but everyone has a thing that's the perfect fit for them. See, you're not an accident. You might not know your full purpose, but you have one. And the journey of discovery is often trial and error and waiting. That's what happened in today's origin story. We're unpacking the lives of some of our oldest ancestors in order to understand ourselves. And today, we get to one of the most famous people who ever lived and one of the most misunderstood. Or at least, I think the point of his story is often misunderstood. So we're going to take it a little at a time. This is from the very first book of the Bible, which we're going through a little bit, at least highlights. And this is Genesis chapter 6. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. And so the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I've created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground. For I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. We kicked off this origin series 2 weeks ago with an incredibly creative experience in creation. God made all these things. He made plants and animals, and then he saw that it was good. That was Genesis 1, the opening words, the opening account, the opening part of our origin story, and it was mind-blowing, unspeakably beautiful, divinely diverse. It was stunning. What's equally stunning to me is that just 5 chapters later, the same God who made all of that and then declared it to be good wants to destroy it because he declares it to be bad. What's going on here? I mean, is God fickle? Is he indecisive? I mean, what happened between Genesis 1 and Genesis 6? What happened there that moved the heart of God to want to dismantle his own dream? Well, Genesis 3 happened. And Pastor Brian Pope taught us about that last week, something we call the fall, the entry of corruption into an otherwise perfect creation. And you think COVID-19 spread fast. It was nothing compared to sin. So as humanity expands with an exponentially growing population, God makes a statement that still has me shaking. And I'm going to tell you up front that I really don't grasp it. I don't know the answer to the question I'm about to pose to you, but I'd rather not ignore it. I'd rather not pretend that I don't see it because you're too smart for that and somebody's going to call me on it. So we're going to get it on the table, a question without an answer, at least not on this side of heaven. Here it is, verse 6. I've already read this for you, but this is what it says. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. The Lord regretted. Some translations say that the Lord was grieved that he had made them. Others say he was sorry he had made them, which begs this question. I mean, here's the question. How can a God who knows all things, past, present, and future, experience regret? I mean, how can he look back on his own decision and grieve He did it. And humans do that, sure, but God, this verse right here, it often shows up in commentaries and books about the hard sayings of the Bible, but I have yet to find one that really answers the question. I mean, those thinkers, they make all kinds of leaps and assumptions that might be true, but they're definitely not conclusive. And by the way, this is not the only time this happens. I mean, God in his creative fervor, occasionally throughout the Bible, we see a few times where he looks on his creation and scratches his head, and like any good artist, he just wants a do-over. So because of what Pastor Brian taught us last week from Genesis 3 and the introduction of sin that infects every person, God grows unhappy about the state of the human heart. He looks from one end of the earth to the other, and he determines that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. Only evil all the time. But there is one person whose inclination is not towards evil, but is towards God. In other words, Noah lives a God-focused life, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. So, is Noah an exception to this sin pandemic? Is he somehow immune to it? Was he the second perfect human being, sinless, preceding Jesus Christ, who also lived a sinless life? Hardly. Spoiler alert, Noah isn't perfect. After the flood, and you do know that's coming, right? After the flood and the waters recede and the boat docks and everybody gets out on dry land, the very first thing Noah does is plant a vineyard and get drunk, completely trashed. I mean, passed out, tore up. And I find this incredibly strange. I mean, just stay with me here. And I mean, seriously, I'm just getting real with you. Wouldn't the time to get drunk be when the whole world was being destroyed? I mean, I'm not advocating it. I'm just saying if you're going to do it, I think Noah's timing is awful. This is one of the basic debates about human nature that this story about Noah highlights. I mean, God looks across the earth, and the question, and he can't find anybody that's good, and the question is, are we inherently good or are we inherently bad? I mean, when God looked out and he saw that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time, well, that was true then. Is it still true today? We want to think we're good. We want to believe that every inclination of the thoughts of our hearts are mostly holy most of the time, or mostly pure some of the time. Certainly not only evil all the time. So which is it? I mean, really, which is it? Are we good or are we bad? Yes. Yes, we are. We are good and we are bad. And I don't mean the collective we, so that you can exclude yourself from half of this, as if some of us are good and others of us are not so good. I don't mean we, I mean me and you. Fast forward a few thousand years, the Apostle Paul, he would say it best like this. I don't understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. And for I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I can't carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I don't want to do, this I keep on doing. I don't understand. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me, waging war. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. Are we good? Only by the grace of God. Are we bad? All you have to do is watch small kids play together to see it. I've got granddaughters now, and I'd love to tell you that they're always sweet, always loving, complete angels all the time, but it wouldn't be true. And it's not true of your kids or grandkids either. But just watch them play together for a few minutes and see how many times you say, "No, Kinsley, you can't stab your sister with Buzz Lightyear. Share now." "No, no, you have to share. No, you can't just take that away from her." Are they sweet sometimes? Of course they are. Absolutely. But not all the time. Because we are both good and bad. My grandfather, who led me to Jesus, insisted that we never forget this. My granddad was a great man, a most holy man I ever knew, closest to God I've ever seen. But he began every prayer. It got to where we would kind of chuckle a little. Every prayer he would begin like this. He would say, "Oh God, we're all just wretched. Just wretched." That's how he started every prayer. That's how he started the Thanksgiving dinner prayer and every other prayer we ever had in our family. He really believed it. And I'm not sure he always had to say it, but it was nevertheless a good reminder. I mean, how could my granddad smile even though he believed he was inherently wretched? Well, I'll show you with Paul's words. "What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." God saw Noah as different, but not perfect, but better than anyone else, because somehow, while everyone else's inclination was always evil all the time, Noah's inclination was towards God, pointing to that which was right and holy and pure. So God picks him, and God tells him the plan, basically saying, and I'm paraphrasing now, "I'm done. We're starting over." God's plan is to wipe out all of the creatures of the earth except for Noah and his family and some animals he'll bring with him. And then God would begin again with that group. And he would do all this destructive work with a flood. Everything on dry land would drown. And God would save Noah, and he would do it through an ark. And God gives Noah very specific instructions on how to make this ark. You can read it in Genesis 6. I encourage you to do that. In fact, this entire narrative, the Noah story, is Genesis 6 through 9. It's not hard to read. It doesn't take very much time. Let me encourage you to do that. But the ark would be 450 feet long, a football field and a half, in case you're wondering, 75 feet wide and 45 feet high. It would make the ark the largest seagoing vessel known to mankind before the 20th century. Only in recent history have we created a boat that was bigger than Noah's. And what's interesting is that the dimensions of his ship recorded in the pages of the Bible thousands of years ago are remarkably consistent with modern ships today. It had a length to width ratio of 6 to 1. The ark would have been incredibly stable, well proportioned, not top heavy, very seaworthy. As I like to say, sometimes every once in a while it occurs to me that God knows what he's doing. And so then he tells Noah, "Okay, you're to bring into the ark two of all kinds of living creatures, male and female, and to keep them alive with you, two of every kind of bird, every kind of animal, every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. You're to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and stored away as food for you and for them, for the animals." Now, some people have argued that there's no way that two of every animal and eight people from Noah's family, that's how many from Noah's family end up on the ark, there's no way that there was enough room for all of that and the food to feed them all. They couldn't have fit. But in fact, there would have been 100,000 square feet of floor space in this thing, and the capacity of 569 modern-day railroad cars. So there are some people who just got curious about this, and more than one of them, and they have kind of investigated and done the calculations and determined that there would have been more than enough space for two of every land animal and the food to feed them all for a year. And as to how Noah got them all together, Genesis 6:20, which we just read a second ago, it says these curious words. It says, "Two of every kind of land animal will come to you." So Noah didn't have to go out into the desert and rainforest and mountaintops and valleys. He didn't have to search for them. The animals came to him. Why do we believe these two pieces of scripture, these two teachings, to be so hard to swallow? I mean, humans built the pyramids. They built the Great Wall of China. They built the Colosseum long before power equipment existed. The ark was entirely possible. And God gave animals their instincts. I mean, the birds that fly thousands of miles every winter in our own country, and then they return again every spring to the exact same location. And they do all of this without a map app or GPS. There are thousands of unanswered questions about how animals behave, and the scientific community is often stumped. They don't know why animals are this clued in to where they should go and what they should do, but we do know that God gave them their instincts. And if we believe that, is it so far-fetched to believe that the same God would simply rewire two of them from every species and send them on a pilgrimage to Noah? And God turned off their carnivorous tendencies so that lions could follow gazelles without eating them. And then all these animals just walked onto the ark and into their respective rooms. Is it so hard to believe that? Once everything was in place and all the animals were accounted for, Noah was ordered to go on board. The Lord then said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I found you righteous in this generation." And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. Noah was 600 years old when the floodwaters came on the earth. The writer of Genesis tells us that the water, when it started to come, it came from both underneath the earth, springs coming up from the ground, and it came from the heavens above the earth in form of rain, and that this went on for 40 days and 40 nights. And the writer goes on to tell us that the water rose so high that the peak of the highest mountain on earth was 20 feet underwater. And so many people who can go along with the building of the ark and maybe even the gathering of the animals, they stop here and they just say that there's simply no way that water could flood the entire earth in this way. Some scientists have even said that it would require three times more water than actually exists on the planet. What is almost undisputable, I mean, no one argues with the fact, though, that a cataclysmic flood happened on earth in ancient times. Every single major religion has a flood story. And while it's not conclusive, there is some archaeological evidence that a flood like the one we're talking about today happened. And in 1872, an ancient text from a Babylonian civilization that's a part of what we now call the Epic of Gilgamesh recounts a flood narrative that is remarkably similar to what we're reading in the Noah account. But is this what God wanted from us, really? A debate about history, a scientific argument about water volumes and rock formations and carbon dating? Is that the point of this story? I mean, if you ask the average person what the story of Noah is about, many people would say, well, I mean, God was unhappy and he flooded the earth. Or some might point to the rainbow, which comes on the end of the story. Some might lament how the world today is as bad as it was then, using a Noah reference to make some political leap. Any excuse will do these days for that. But I think that there's a very practical application in this origin story. And it's really not about the past as much as it's about right now. Check this out. Why was it necessary to have two of all the animals brought onto the ark? The simple answer would be that it takes a male and a female to make a baby, whatever species that is. And God wanted to repopulate the earth. After the floodwaters receded, he even said that was part of his point, right? So it's just biology, Brian. I'm not sure why you're confused. But look deeper. I mean, is it really true? Was it really necessary to have a mama and papa elephant, a mother and father goat, a mom and dad horse? And now you really think I've lost my mind. I get it. You're not tracking with me. See, in Genesis chapter 1, God creates the earth from nothing. He creates the water from nothing, the land from nothing, and the animals from nothing. Wouldn't this whole encounter, this whole endeavor been so much easier on everybody if God had just come to Noah and said, hey, listen, Noah, this whole thing is not working. People have turned so far from me that I'm just going to wipe everything out. Now, I'm going to do it with a flood. So, Noah, you need to build a boat, and you need to have it for your whole family. So make it comfortable, because you're going to be in there for a while. And that part of the story I get. I mean, God wants to save Noah, fine. Build a boat or a yacht maybe. But an ark? I mean, isn't this the same God who snapped his fingers and spoke animals into existence in the first place? Why not just do that again? Let them all drown with the rest of the animals. Don't take two each on the ark. You don't need them, because later on, God, you can just speak and make a new pair and everything can just start all over again. In fact, there are a few animals, if I got to have this argument with God, that I think we ought to leave out of creation, like mosquitoes and mice, possums and cats. Well, I know some of you are cat lovers, and right now you can't wait to get home and take me off your Christmas list, but I'm just saying. I mean, truthfully, though, God could have snapped his fingers after the flood, and Noah could have built a cozy 4-bedroom ship in a year instead of the 100 years it took him to build the ark. Why did God do it this way? Because the promise of God is that he not only saves people who pursue him, but he uses them for a greater purpose. God promises to use you to do something great if you will submit your life to him. Once we've moved beyond Genesis 1 and men and women come on the scene, God ceases to operate on his own from that point forward, and he always uses people to work with him. Is that so that God can spread the workload? I mean, is he overwhelmed and needs help? Of course not. He's God. He doesn't need us. He just wants us. He has a purpose for us that goes beyond the temporary pleasure of being happy and stretches into the lasting joy of being important. In the summer of 2005, the London Zoo posted a sign in front of their brand new exhibit, and it read this: "Warning, humans in their natural environment." The exhibit featured, I'm not kidding about this, 8 people in a sealed enclosure, in a cage, adjacent to another cage that had various other primates in it. And the human captives were chosen from an online contest. They volunteered for this. And so inside the cage, people observed them. They were spending their time sunning on a rock ledge or playing board games. They would wave to spectators. And there was a sign out front that told the visitors about the Homo sapiens and their diets and their habitat and the population and the threats against their existence. The goal of this exhibit, according to the zoo, was to downplay the uniqueness of human beings as a species. It said, "Seeing people in a different environment among other animals teaches members of the public that the human is just another primate. And when they see humans as animals, here in our zoo, it kind of reminds them that we're not that special." Is that right? Are we just one more kind of animal? What about the account of Noah reinforces for us here, for me anyway, is that while we might be like animals in many ways, we are not one of them. There were 2 of every kind of animal on the ark. There were 7 of a few kinds of animals, but there were 8 human beings. And I might be reading more into this than is fair, but I think there's a symbolic importance to it. We are more important to God than the rest of creation. No disrespect to your beloved pet, and I mean that, but we are the supreme object of God's love. And he wants us to experience the joy of knowing that we were a part of his plan. We might be like some animals in many ways, but we are different in the most significant of ways. That is, God wants to use us to orchestrate his plan for the world. And talking about the way that Christians view the world, a Roman Catholic theologian, a guy named George Weigel, he said this. He said, "We are not congealed stardust, an accidental byproduct of cosmic chemistry. We are not just something," he said. "We are someone." You know, this ark thing was not the easiest way to do it. If Genesis 1 shows us anything, it's that God can create something out of nothing, and he can do it quite well without our help. He could have done it again in Genesis 6. But when God wanted to start over, he could have snapped his fingers and made an ark with no help from Noah. God wants to include us. He wants to include you in His plan to rescue the world. He wants you to experience the joy of knowing that you helped make someone's life better, maybe even helped their future be altered or altered their eternity. God invites you, like Noah, to be a part of saving the world from a demise of its own making. We do live in a broken world, and we did break it, but thanks be to God, He didn't just do something, He called us to.
I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now, thought, how we ever get so far down, and how we ever gonna turn around, so I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty and children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. I created you. Come on. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? It's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. I'm so tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be, and live like angels of apathy who tell ourselves it's alright, somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. I don't want a flame, I want a fire. I want to be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me, it's time for us to do something, yeah. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? It's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. We are the salt of the earth. We are a city on a hill.
Shine, 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 shine.
We're never gonna change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No, we won't stand still. If not me and you, right now, it's time for us to do something, yeah. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? It's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. It's time for us to do something. It's time for us to do something. Come on, let's do something. God wants you in His plan to rescue the world. He wants you to experience the joy of knowing that you helped make someone's life better, maybe even helped alter their future and their eternity. So go
join the Dream Team, fill out an Operation Christmas Child shoebox, or whatever God is calling you to do. Whatever you do, just do something. Make a difference right now. And also check out this week's follow-up video on our website or on our app for more ideas on just how you can do that. Invite a friend, and we will see you back here next week.